Amen. I see the growing leader in you. Forceful leader in you. Successful leader in you. It will happen. The Lord will make you climb all your mountains in Jesus' name. And you will excel in leadership. I will excel in leadership. Once again, we're happy you are here. And the Lord who has brought you will make you a blessing to all the people he has ordained for you to lead in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for your people. Thank you for our leaders. Thank you for this year. Lord, we pray that you make this year a special year for everyone. Spectacular. That your hand will be mighty upon everyone. Everyone will remain strong in the Lord in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. We're looking at John chapter 10. And we're reading from verses 11 to 14. John 10, verse 11. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is an hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, sees the wolf coming, and leaveth the sheep, and flees, and the wolf catches them, and scattereth the sheep. The hireling flees, because he's an hireling, and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and I'm known of mine. Today, as we begin a leadership series, I'm going to look at Christ in his leadership, and then you and I, as we follow in the leadership style, leadership method, leadership path, leadership progress of the Lord Jesus Christ. Tonight, I'm talking to you on leading the flock of Christ with Christ-like love. Leading the flock of Christ with Christ-like love. As we look at Christ as shepherd, Christ as a savior, Christ as a leader, and Christ as the captain of our salvation, we see the perfection of leadership in Christ, that whatever he was going through, whatever the challenge he had, he always focused on leading the people the way he ought to lead them. Look at chapter 13, John chapter 13, verse 1. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own, which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. He loved his disciples. He loved the sheep. He loved the saints. He loved his followers unto the end. And then he showed them what he should do. As he bent down in lowliness, in meekness, in humility, and he washed the feet of his disciples. He laid the towel aside and then said, look at verse 15, for I have given you an example that ye should do as I have done unto you. He said, I've laid down the example of leadership, and I want you to look at all that I've done, not only in washing the saints' feet, but all that he did in leading and guiding them. And he said, I want you to follow that example, leading the flock of Christ with Christ-like love. As you look at Christ, and you summarize everything concerning the leadership style of Jesus Christ, you write the word leadership. L He was loving. Having loved his own, he loved them to the very end. He called them because he loved them. He trained them because he loved them. He put himself, everything is God, he put into them so that they will be the kind of leaders they ought to be. El loving. He equipping, equips them. He didn't just send them out to go and do what they ought to do without empowering them, without energizing them, without enabling them. He equips them. And so as we lead, as we're following the leadership style of Jesus, number one, we love. You keep on loving the people you're leading, and then you're equipping them. Are you bringing up a training program so that you can equip them? Are you looking at their deficiencies and all their needs, and then you're equipping them? Are you energizing them, encouraging them? He was advancing them, advancing them. Every meeting he had with them and every challenge he posed before them, he was advancing them and lifting them up so that what they were today, they were not like that yesterday. Every day will be adding something to them. Every week adding something to them. Every month adding something to them. And if we're following the leadership style of Jesus Christ, we're loving people. We're loving the workers. We're loving the members. We're loving the various sections, whether they have deficiencies or not, and whether they have inconsistencies or not. That's why we're their leaders. We love them all the same, and we equip them, and we advance them, advance them, advance them in knowledge, advance them in understanding, advance them in vision, advance them in consecration, advancing them, not advise, but advance, lifting them, moving them forward. D, discipling them, that everything they ought to know, are they disciplined? Then you disciple them so that the discipline of the Spirit will come upon their lives. You are discipling them and teaching them the word of God. You are discipling them and teaching them the way of the Lord. You are discipling them and showing them what they ought to be and what they ought to do. He exemplifying what you are teaching, exemplifying. Jesus gave an example. He said, I am among you as he that serveth. I teach you about service, I serve. I tell you about teaching, I teach. I counsel you about preaching, I preach. And I send you forth to heal, and I heal. Everything he expected them to do, he exemplified. That's leadership. When you can exemplify everything you're teaching, when you can exemplify the doctrines of the word of God. In your family, you exemplify the doctrines of the word. In your interaction, interrelationship, you exemplify the word of God you're teaching are reproducing himself in them. He that believeth on me, the works I do, he shall do. And greater works than this shall he do, because I go to the Father. You're reproducing. You are not just saying, do as I say, but don't do as I do. You are the first person to practice what you are teaching. The sound doctrine, the holiness of life, the gentleness in life, and the fruit of the Spirit. You are the first person to exemplify and say, this is the way it ought to be done. When they look at your example, they'll be able to follow your exhortation. You're reproducing yourself in them. Are you courageous? Reproduce courage in them. Are you standing firm? Reproduce that kind of standing up and standing up for Christ in their lives. A life that will not compromise. A life that will not bend, that will not yield. You are exemplifying all that personality development in them. Yes, you are sacrificing. Jesus Christ sacrificed. There were times he was tired, he kept on walking. There were times opposition came, he kept on walking. There were times it appeared that the Pharisees will not allow him, but they couldn't stop him. He kept on doing the work the Father had sent him to do. He was sacrificing, he was harvesting, harvesting. He said, that's why I came. I came to call sinners to repentance. He said, that's why I came to seek and to save the lost. In our lives, as we're leading and as we're encouraging other people, we are harvesting. I is instructing, always instructing them, always showing them the word, always showing them, this is the word of God, this is what it means, and these are the applications to your life. P, persevering, always persevering. That's the leadership style of Jesus Christ. And as we look at Jesus Christ, in everything that he did, in everything that he said, as he trained and taught the people, we too will want to get that from Christ, because he wants us actually to follow after his steps. Now, all those 10 characteristics I give you, loving, equipping, advancing, discipling, exemplifying, reproducing, sacrificing, harvesting, instructing, persevering, they all finish with ing. He didn't just do it and then stopped. He kept on doing, kept on doing. It's the constancy, it's the continuity, it's the continual thing that he did. And so, as we also get into the mode and the model and the method of Christ's teaching, we don't just do it and stop. We don't do it for this section and stop. We keep on moving on and doing it and doing it. The Lord will give you all his characteristics and implant it in every one of our lives in Jesus' name. I said the Lord will give us his characteristics in Jesus' name. Leading the flock of Christ with Christ-like love. We're dividing the message of three parts. Number one, feeding the church for life and ministry. Feeding the church for life and ministry. That's what Jesus did. He fed the people. He fed his disciples. He fed his followers. He fed the ministers in training. He fed them with the word of God. Number one, for their personal lives. And number two, for the ministry he called them to. Number one, feeding the church for life and ministry. Number two, for bearing like Christ in lowliness and meekness. For bearing. If you cannot endure, you'll not be a leader. If you cannot forbear, you'll not be a leader. If you fly at everything you see, and if you complain about everything that happens, if you murmur because this has happened, that has happened, you cannot be a leader. The Lord Jesus Christ forbore with his disciples. And so as we lead our members, as we lead the ministers, as we lead those who are training, as we lead the workers, we forbear like Christ forbore in lowliness and meekness. Point number three, fruit bearing for Christ with love and maturity. Fruit bearing for Christ with love and maturity. That's actually the reason why he called us. It is to bear fruit. You will bear fruit. If we say we're leading, if we say we're ministering, if we say we're preaching, if we say we're teaching and training, and there's no fruit, and there's no result, and people's lives are not being touched, people's lives are not being transformed, and we're just doing the rigmarole, we come now, we come again, we come now, we come again, and the people come as they ought to come, but there is no impact in their lives, and there is no impartation to them, and there is no improvement in their lives, then we're not doing the work. The reason we're doing the work is so we can bear fruit. Fruit bearing for Christ with love and maturity. Let's come back to point number one. Feeding the church for life and ministry. That is, for their lives, personal lives. We feed them so that their lives will be what their lives ought to be, and so that their ministries will be what their ministries ought to be. John chapter 21, and I'm reading from verse 15. John chapter 21, verse 15. So when they are dying, Jesus says to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He says unto him, Yea, Lord, yes, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He says unto him, Feed my lambs. You see, the evidence that we love the Lord is that we care for what he cares for. And we're interested in what he's interested in. And we concentrate on what he concentrates on. He loves the lambs. He loves the young believers. He loves the converts. He'll follow up on them. He'll visit them. He wants them to be strong. He wants them to grow. And if we love the Lord, we will show it on the lambs. If we love the Lord, we'll show it on the young converts. He said, you say you love me more than all these, then give me more time than you give to all those things. And give me more attention than you give to all those things. And give my lambs, and give my followers, and give my sheep more time, more resources, more skill, more concentration than you give to all those other things. Verse 16, it says unto him again, the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He wanted a repetition for a confirmation. He wanted the thing to sink down deep into his heart. He wanted him to say again and reverse all the three times that he denied the Lord. He wanted him to reverse all that. And so he says again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He says unto him, Yea, Lord, yes, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He says unto him, Feed my sheep. Don't think the sheep will feed themselves. And we shouldn't think the members will feed themselves. They have all these gadgets and they have all these things they can use to feed themselves if they're really serious. The Bible study is there. The Sunday worship is there. All those things are there on the net. If they were really serious, then they will go there. They'll feed themselves. It says, you show that you love me by feeding my lambs and by feeding my sheep. Some of them are slow, feed them. Some of them are quick, feed them. Some of them are discouraged, feed them. Some of them are encouraged, feed them. Some of them are healthy, feed them. Some of them are sickly, feed them. Some of them are slow to learn, feed them all the same. Don't ever say, I will not, you know, do that again or not feed them again, because they are not cooperating. They are not accepting. It's not about they, it's about him, the one you love, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he said, don't look at their attitude. Don't look at their disposition. I have called you and I've asked you, do you love me more than all these? And you have said yes. Okay, if you love me like that, feed my lambs and feed my sheep. In verse 17, he says unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Lovest thou me? And the Lord is asking us the same question. And whenever there is maybe any difficulty, you check up on your love. Whenever you say, I don't think I'll go to the meeting today. I don't think I will prepare for the Thursday revival hour today. I think I'll just push it on another person. You're always pushing to another person. And in the previous years, all the time you say you are supervising, you are here on Thursday, and you don't teach, you don't preach, you don't pray. And you reserve all the prayers till the GS will come and then pray for the people. How about your part and the work the Lord has given you? Are you always transferring? Always transferring the thing to the lower leadership level so that they will do it. They will do it. If there's anything to be done, you stay in your house and just tell somebody standing for me there, go and do evangelism. That's not love. That's not love. If you say you love the Lord this year, you must bring everything you have into that love. So he asked him the third time. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved. Peter, don't be grieved. After all, don't you remember? Those three times you said, I don't know him. He wasn't that grieved to abandon you. And then second time, I don't know what you're talking about. He wasn't great to the point. He will not come to you. And then the third time, I don't know what you're saying. I don't know him. And he still came to you. And he's saying to you, go tell my disciples and Peter that I meet, they should meet me in Galilee. If the Lord has shown that love, unrestrained love, that love that continued all the time, if he has shown it to you, why are you disturbed that he's asking you the third time, lovest thou me? God has a reason. Christ has a reason to ask you over and over and over again. Because he looks at your attitude, because he looked at your time-saving gimmicks, because he looks at your restraint, and because he looks at the limitation of the demonstration of your love, he has a right to ask you over and over, lovest thou me more than all these, more than business, more than your corporation, more than your company, more than your workplace, more than the market, more than produce, more than traveling, lovest thou me? Do you abandon my work for your own personal things and then profess you love me? He has a reason to ask us, to ask you and to ask me a number of times. It says Peter was grieved because he said unto him, the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. That's what the Lord is expecting from you and expecting from me. That's the reason he appointed us. Are you a pastor? Are you a preacher? That's the reason he appointed you as a pastor, that you are to feed the people of God. You are to feed the lambs. You are to feed the new converts. You are to feed the young ones and feed them with saving truth, the truth that will save them and the truth that will transform their lives. Look at Jeremiah chapter 3. And we're reading from verse 15. Jeremiah chapter 3, verse 15. And I will give you pastors according to mine heart. If you find any pastor who is according to his own heart, I've not given that one to you. If you find any pastor who is according to his own self-will, I've not given him to you. If you find any minister, if you find any worker who must have his way, by all means, even if he destroys the flock, even if he destroys the children, even if he destroys the youth, even if it scatters the flock, they must have their own way. Having their own heart, having their own way is the number one priority of their lives. The work they're giving to do and the things they're to minister is not the number one thing. If that is so in any life, the Lord has not given us such a pastor, such a preacher, and such a shepherd. If it's a pastor the Lord has given us, it will be according to God's own mind. Which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding? Which shall feed you with knowledge and understanding? And that's what leaders are to do. And that's what Jesus told Peter to do. And that's what Jesus had told all the other disciples, all his other ministers to do. And that's what the Lord has told us too, that we will be according to his own heart, according to his own mind, and we will teach knowledge. Feed the people with knowledge. You know, there are times people might feed us with knowledge, but it's so scanty, and it's so small, and it doesn't really feed us. It's like they just whet our appetite, and we're still hungry. That's why some of the sheep are going here and there, because they're not satisfied. Feed them, and feed them to the point they're satisfied, and they have knowledge, and they know that this is the truth, and they will not deviate from the truth. And with understanding, they will understand the way of the Lord. They'll understand the path they ought to follow. We should so teach that the knowledge of God will not be a strange thing eluding the people we're teaching, and the understanding will be so clear because we have taught them the word of God. God will help you, and God will keep on helping me. And what God helps me to do, it will help you to do. And amen. Chapter 23 of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 23. I'm reading from verse 4. And I will set up shepherds over them. I, the Almighty God said, I'm the one to set up. I'm the owner of the flock. That's God. God says, I'm the owner of the flock and the owner of the sheep. And because they're all mine, I'm the one to set up shepherds over them. Not by voting, not politics. It is not by, you know, the majority carries the vote, democracy. No, it is the Lord himself who is the chief shepherd, who is going to set up shepherds over them. And he who sets them up also has the right to put them down if they're not bearing fruit. Because the reason why he sets up the shepherd is so that they will go forth and bear fruit. And I will set up shepherds over them which shall feed them, and they shall fear no more. Underline that in the Bible. They shall fear no more. When you study any part of the Bible, if the people become more afraid than they were before, they are afraid of the world, they are afraid of the powers that be, they are afraid of powers of darkness, they are afraid of something behind the curtain, they are afraid of this, they are afraid of that. We have not taught them well, and we have not taught the word of God like we ought to teach the word of God. If they are afraid of the future, afraid of today, afraid of tomorrow, if they are afraid and they have doubts, am I sins forgiven? Am I really saved? Am I really a child of God? And they always doubt him. They are afraid of taking the Lord's Supper. We have been teaching them and teaching them and teaching them. And they will say the Lord's Supper is going to take place this coming Sunday. And they are afraid to even take the Lord's Supper. We're not teaching them well. If we're teaching them well, it says they shall fear no more, nor be dismayed, neither shall they be lacking, says the Lord. There'll be no lack in their lives if we're teaching them aright. If we're teaching and developing their faith, we're teaching and developing their love. We're teaching and we're developing them in the way we ought to. There'll be no fear. There'll be no lack. And it is not, you just don't grab your Bible and say, I'm going to teach. Have you prepared? Have you prayed? Have you delved into the word of God and say, I know the congregation. I know the people. I know their hunger. I know their desire. I know their sickness. I know their insufficiency. I know their need. And then from the knowledge of their need, as you're praying, then you prepare. And through that need and through that preparation, you feed them, all their fears will evaporate. Look at Matthew chapter 24. In Matthew chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 45. Who then is a faithful and wise servant? Who then is a faithful and wise steward? Who then is a faithful and wise pastor? Who then is a faithful and wise shepherd? Whom his Lord made ruler over his household to give them meat in due season? To feed them. It's not the rod that's important. It's not the cudgel that's important. It's not beating people, browbeating people, that's important. It's not shouting on people, bullying them, that's important. It's not making them shiver, tremble, that's important. It's not making slaves of them, that's important. All that is not the intention of the Lord. He said it is to give them meat, is to give them spiritual food in due season. Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. ING. They're doing it, they're doing it, they're doing it. And by the time the Lord comes, they have not retired. By the time the Lord comes, they have not said, I'm tired, I cannot go on anymore. You're not tired to go to your place of work. You're tired to go to church. You're not tired of selling clothes. You are tired of giving them the garment of righteousness. You are not tired of traveling to a far place so that you can buy things and sell and make money. And you are tired of reaching out and getting the bread of life from the far country, from heaven, and feeding the people. You see the people that say that they are tired, and yet they are expending more energy on earthly things. They really do not love the Lord. The Lord said, blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Verily I say unto you, that he shall make him ruler over all his goods. He will reward you. He will reward us. None of us will meet that final reward in Jesus' name. One of our children has been going to school, and she's gone to school for secondary 1, 2, 3, junior secondary, and then senior secondary 1, 2. Is now in secondary 3 and about to take the exam. Something came upon him, something came upon her, and then he withdrew from school. And everybody kept on pleading. He said, no, I'm not interested anymore. I cannot go on anymore. You spent 5 years, you spent 5.5 years, and just to stay and finish, he says, no, I don't want to continue. I don't see the reason to continue. What do you say of such a child? She's wasted 5.5 years. Think about us as leaders who've been feeding the people of God for 2 years, for 5 years, and for 7 years, and for maybe 9 years, and something happens, and something just came upon such a pastor and such a leader, and he says, this is too much. If I cannot have my way, I'm not doing any other thing. If I cannot, you know, beat anyone I have and oppress anyone I have and abuse anyone I have, I want to abuse and insult anyone. If I cannot control them like a military man controls the barrack, if I cannot do that, I'm not continuing. I must have my way. And because he could not have his way, he wants to withdraw. How about all the years you're putting? The Lord wants to find you so doing, feeding and teaching and leading the people of God until he comes. I pray you will not fall out and you will not fall away. I pray that what you have committed yourself to, you'll not allow self, you'll not allow the flesh, you'll not allow self-will and stubbornness to make you quit. You will not quit in Jesus' name. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 20, I'm reading from verse 28. Acts chapter 20, I'm reading from verse 28. Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves, there'll be something that may want to rise up in you. The depravity that Christ has taken away at the point of sanctification, the self-will that Christ has taken away at the point of sanctification, and all that kind of a rugged personality that has been taken away during the time of sanctification, that thing may want to come back. You want to have your way again. You want to be rough again. You want to be uncontrollable again. You want to be incorrigible. Take heed unto yourselves, unto yourself. Check your own spiritual life. Check your own attitude. Am I still following Christ? Christ is still moving on in love. Am I still walking in love? Christ is moving on and is equipping the people. Am I equipping the people? Christ is moving on. Is advancing the people. Is encouraging the people. Is moving them forward. Am I doing the same thing? Christ is discipling the people. Am I still discipling the people? Or have I abandoned all those things? What I want to do now is to show that this is who I am, and I want to now impose my personality. Christ is still going on and is still going with the people. He's exemplifying his message. He talks about humility, and he talks about lowliness, and he talks about meekness, and he's still exemplifying that. What are you doing? What are you doing? Have you forgotten? You have to follow Christ in your leadership. Are you reproducing any good thing? Are you sacrificing anything at all? Are you still harvesting, or have you stood by the side of the road? Are you still instructing? Are you still persevering? Take heed unto yourself. Don't allow pride to come in. Don't allow haughtiness to come in. Don't allow high-mindedness to come in. Get rid of all that. All those things are not important. What's important is what the Lord has called us to do, that you keep on following Christ in leadership. God will help us. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock. And to all the flock. You cannot turn your eyes away from this part of the flock. I can't talk to them. I won't talk to them. I won't do anything with them. They're all given to you. And you have to lead everyone. You have to love everyone. And you have to transform everyone with the word of God and the word of life. They are hungry too. And you need to feed everyone. Take it unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers. Over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. That's how precious the church is, the purchase of the Lord with the precious blood of Christ. Well then, if we're feeding the church, if we're feeding the flock, we're feeding every individual, we're feeding every family, we're feeding every section, and we're feeding them for life, that their lives, number one, they'll have eternal life. If we're feeding them with the word of God and they are not saved, and every time somebody preaches salvation, they're raising up their hands, you're not feeding them. You must so feed them that they know that they know that they know that they have eternal life. They are born again. They know their names are written in the book of life. And then you're feeding them their victorious life. Victorious life. The life that is victorious above sin. Not that we go on teaching the same thing over and over, and the people do not know how to resist the devil, how to have the victory. Victory over sin, victory over sickness, and victory over Satan. That the people were teaching, after all these many years, they have headache, they have to look for somebody to pray for them. And they have a running tummy, they have to look for somebody to pray for them. And they have, you know, something in the night that knocked somewhere, and they have to look for, they want to go for deliverance. After you've been teaching them for 15 years, we need to teach them that they know that they have victorious life in Christ. We need to teach until they have conquering life, that they conquer everything that comes against them. They will conquer in Jesus' name. Well then, the teaching will give, what kind of life should it give to the people we're teaching? Number one, undefiled life. Undefiled life. If we're teaching properly, our people will know, our people will hear, and our people will stand righteous and holy. They will have undefiled life. Look at Psalm 119. I'm reading from verse 1. Psalm 119, We're reading from verse 1. It says, blessed are the undefiled in the way, who walk in the law of the Lord. Teach them to the point that they are undefiled. Teach them to the point they are uncompromising. They know the truth. Whether you are there or not, they know the truth. Whether members of Deeper Life are there with them or not, they know the truth, and they will not compromise. And they will say, here is where I stand. And that's how to teach, that to teach them, they know what they believe. And whatever comes, and whatever the challenge, and whatever the trial, they will stand uncompromisingly living for the Lord. Daniel chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 8. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. His pastor was not there. His father was not there. His mother was not there. And all the people that could say, what are you doing there? Checking up on him. They were not there. But all the same, he had been taught to the point he could live an uncompromising life. We teach them to the point that they live unspotted lives. Unspotted lives. In James chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 27. James chapter 1 verse 27. Pure religion and undefiled before God is this, and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in the affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. To keep himself unspotted from the world. When we teach people, we teach them and they embrace what we teach. They believe what we teach. They live by what we teach. The grace of God is in them to live an unspotted life. Number 4, unreprovable life. Unreprovable life. In Colossians, I'm reading from chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, and we're looking at verse 22. Colossians chapter 1, verse 22. In the body of his flesh, through death, to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. Unreprovable in his sight. That's what we're teaching people. We're not excusing sin. We're not excusing backsliding. We're not excusing waywardness. We're not excusing lawlessness. We so teach them that their lives are undefiled. Their lives are uncompromising. Their lives are unspotted. Their lives are unreprovable. Their lives are unfeigned. Unfeigned. They're not pretending. They're not pretending. They're not people that have eye service. When the pastor is there, this is how they behave. When the pastor is not there, this is how they behave. That's feigned behavior. That's hypocritical behavior. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, reading from verse 22. This is the reason for teaching, and this is the goal of teaching. This is the result of teaching, that the lives of the people we teach will be unfeigned, unpretending. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22, seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love. Unpretending love, unhypocritical love, unfeigned love of the brethren, see that she love one another with a pure heart fervently, and their lives are unblameable. Their lives are unblameable. The people we're teaching, if we teach them aright, if we teach them correctly, and they accept and they possess and they personalize what we're teaching, it's not that, you know, because we're carrying a weave and we're running after them, don't do this, don't do this, do this and do that. We're not controlling them from outside, but from the inside. The Spirit of God in them is controlling them and directing them that this is what your life ought to be. We're looking at 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 10. Verse 10, night and day praying exceedingly that we might see your face and might perfect that which is lacking in your faith. Paul the apostle said, when we come to you, We're coming to you for one reason only. We're going to look at your life and your profession of faith, in your behavior and your character, in your relationship with the Lord. We'll see what is lacking in your faith. We want to perfect it. Why? Verse 13, to the end, for the purpose, he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness before God. That's what we're coming to do. And that's why we're teaching you. And that's the reason we want to give you the word of God, so you'll be unblameable in holiness before God, even our Father, at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all his saints. We teach them so that their lives are unmovable. They're not shifting sands. They're not people that they are here today, they are there tomorrow, they are up today, they are down tomorrow. We teach them in such a way that they are unmovable, unmovable. Whatever wind may blow, whatever challenge may come, whatever trial, temptation may come, they are unmovable. Check up on your converts. Check up on the people you have been teaching. Check up on the people you have been leading. Check up on members of your local church. Are they like this? Are you teaching them to have eternal life? Are you teaching them to have victorious life? Are you teaching them to have conquering life? Are you producing in them, through the grace of God, an undefiled life, an uncompromising life, an unspotted life, an unreprovable life, an unfeigned life, an unblameable life, an unmovable life? In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable. Steadfast, unmovable. Not that we find them at the beginning of the year, they are all there. Then when we come to the middle of the year, they're no more there again. Teach in such a way that the people you are teaching, they have conviction. And whether you are there with them in their houses or not will not matter. They are unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Your labor will not be in vain. My labor will not be in vain. Say it for yourself, my labor will not be in vain. Point number two now, forbearing like Christ in lowliness and meekness. Forbearing like Christ in lowliness and meekness. There is a way leadership in the church, leadership following after the example of Christ, will comport itself. There is the kind of leadership in the world that is boisterous, overpowering, imposing, bullying, treading on people, pushing people down so they can go their way. Leadership in the church doesn't do that. Why? Because Christ did not live that way. And Christ did not lead that way. And Christ did not show that kind of example. The example he showed, look at Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11, we're reading from verse 29. Matthew chapter 11, verse 29, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. As you lead, don't take for granted you know what to do. And don't do the same old thing that you did in the old year. But now as we come to this new year, and you say, I'm following after Christ, the example of Christ, the leadership style of Christ, I want to be more and more like Christ. He said, take my yoke upon you. The yoke will restrain you. The yoke will restrict you. The yoke will make you go the straight line and the straight path you ought to go. You are yoked with Christ in the ministry. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. You learn of Christ. What will Christ do? How will Christ do it? How will Christ lead? How will Christ direct people? How will Christ influence people? It says, learn of me. for I am meek and lowly in heart. That's the Lord. That's the Lord. I am meek and lowly in heart. It says, as I lead, as I teach, as I labor, from my heart, I'm lowly in the heart. I am meek in the heart. And ye shall find rest unto your souls. There's no point leading other people and then you become restless. There's no point leading other people and then you become doubtful of your getting to heaven. There's no point leading other people and having your own way and then you go astray. And Jesus says, you're following a stranger, you're not following me. If you were following me, your leadership style will have lowliness and will have meekness. We're coming to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 2. Ephesians chapter 4, and we're reading from verse 2. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2, it says, this is how to lead, with all lowliness and meekness. That's how to lead. That's how to live. That's how to comport yourself. That's how to organize your life. But you know, a leader, a preacher, a pastor that never thinks of Christ in any situation, in any conflict, in any community, and in anything that happens in the local church, and he has forgotten that he was placed there in leadership so he can follow the example of Christ, he has forgotten and he's gone back to his old unconverted days, what he used to do, how he used to live. He's gone back to what he used to do when he was senior prefect or senior girl in a secondary school without salvation. And he says, this is how I'm going to lead. I'll bring them at a standstill and I will show them this is what to do. The Lord Jesus said, learn of me now. It's my church. It's my flock. They're my sheep. They're my ministers. They're my people. And I placed you there so you will do what I would have done if I were there. I would lead in lowliness and meekness. And what you should do is to also lead in lowliness and meekness. Look at that verse 2. With all lowliness, all lowliness. What does that mean? There are people below you in status, in social circle, and in education, they're below you. There's a kind of lowliness you ought to have. There are people like your colleagues, they're at par with you, and they have the same knowledge you have, certificates you have, and they're just like you. Lowliness, all lowliness. There are people of a different gender. You are a man, and they are women. Yet all the same, with all lowliness. You're an adult and they are young. With all lowliness, we don't come as if we come with such a bullying authority. And when we come, the people are afraid. They know I'm the leader because they're trembling. Lowliness doesn't make anybody to tremble. There are people who are above you in age. They are above you in education. They are above you in knowledge and understanding. And when you lead them, you lead with all lowliness and with meekness. That's what the Word of God says. And if your leadership style and if your approach is different from that, then you have missed the way. If you are not leading like Christ, you know that when Christ comes, there will be no reward. You've wasted your life. I pray you'll not waste your life. You've wasted your resources. I pray you'll not waste your resources. All the sacrifices we have, everything we demonstrate, the self-denial, it's all wasted. Once there's no lowliness and meekness, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. That's leadership according to Christ's method, according to Christ's approach. We're coming to Philippians chapter 2. And I'm reading from verse 3. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind. You see that? In lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. If you're looking at yourself better than everybody else, that's pride. That's pride. There's no other word for that. And pride, those who are proud will be abased by the Lord. Pride will not have a way, will not have a place in the kingdom of God. That means then that Christ-like leadership, in Christ-like leadership, there's no room for lawlessness. When you're meek and lowly, you'll not be lawless. I don't care what they say. I don't care what anybody says. I don't care what the pastor thinks about this. I'm going to have my own way. That's lawlessness. That's not lowliness. In Christ's leadership, Christ-like leadership, there is no room for enmity. Something had happened last year. Something had happened years before. And you're still having that in the heart. And your leadership now is that, okay, this happened. And they said, I'm not a leader. I come back now and I'm going to show people that I am a leader. That's not lowliness. You're revenging on the people. What somebody else somewhere at the headquarters has done against you. In Christ-like leadership, there's no room for enmity. In Christ-like leadership, there's no room for anger. You know, people, they're bitter, they're angry. And they say they're pastors. They're angry at this, they're angry at that. The tone of voice and the demeanor and the character, everything is like, you know, there is anger. That's not good. That's not right. And in Christian leadership, Christ-like leadership, there is no room for drunkenness. Drunk with power. Is drunk with position, is drunk with skill, is drunk with ability. And the position he has and the place he holds makes him drunk like wine. That's not leadership in the Bible sense, that, you know, even the air, the atmosphere around him, the man is drunk. The woman is drunk. In Christian leadership, Christ-like leadership, there is no room for extortion. Extortion, you know, because I'm a leader, I take this from that, I borrow that, I borrow this from that, and you are not paying back. And when the fellow confronts you, hey, don't talk to me like that, I'm a leader. Because I owe you a few thousands, a few millions, you're talking to me like that. If you don't know, I will tell you, I'm pastor of Deeper Life. Ah, is that so? A pastor is a debtor, and who will not pay back. And you extort people. In Christ-like leadership, there's no room for rebellion. There's no room for rioting. There's no room for strife in Christ-like leadership. He wants us to be lowly, and he wants us to be meek. In Christ-like leadership, there is no room for hypocrisy. You will not be hypocritical. Who you are will be who you are. Anywhere you are, you are gentle here, you are gentle there, you are lowly here, you are lowly there, you are meek here, you are meek over there. In Christian Christ-like leadership, there's no room for idolatry. Idolatry. You see, there are people, they idolize people. And whatever that person says, even though that thing is wrong, they so idolize a man, they so idolize a woman that they go astray, they derail from the path of Christ. In Christ-like leadership, there is no room for idolatry. In Christ-like leadership, there's no room for pride. You see, when you are corrected, and you deliberately come back and do exactly the same thing, that's pride. You're saying, I'm untouchable. I'm unteachable. You must complete that sentence. So you are unusable. If you are unteachable and you are untouchable, you must understand God will not use you. That's pride. Unteachable, untouchable, unusable. So, as we talk about Christ's leadership will not admit El Lucifer, the one who comes and he says, I am all in all. I will exalt my throne above the throne of God. I will. There's no room in Christ's leadership and in Christ's flock for licentious Lucifer. In Christ's leadership, Christ will not admit Esau, the one whose stomach is the number one. What am I going to do with the birthright? When once I'm hungry, the people that will abandon every other thing, abandon ministry, abandon preaching, abandon work, abandon their privilege because they are hungry. Esau, there's no room and there is no place for Christ leadership in Esau. There's no place like for Absalom. Absalom, that all he wants is just to, you know, if you they brought your case to me, I would judge you right. But you know, daddy doesn't have assistant. And if I were made the assistant, I will tell you, I will show you what I can do. And stole the hearts of the people away. There's no place for abominable Absalom. In Christ's leadership, there's no place for Diotrephes. Bullying on people, scattering people, treading on people, walking on people. And he's saying, I am the one here. Nobody can touch me. Nobody can remove me. And if you are not happy, then you can go out. You cannot do anything unless I say, do it. And anyone coming from anywhere, John coming from the headquarters, Peter coming from the headquarters, anybody coming, tell them before they come, I stand in here and nobody can dictate anything to me. Diotrephes, there's no place in the kingdom of God. There's no place in the leadership for Diotrephes. There's no place for effeminate Eli, the one that is just in children. I hear reports about you. I hope these things change. You know, if somebody has a quarrel with somebody, they can easily say to you, but if God has something against you, effeminate, cannot stand, and did not have any backbone. There's no place for Eli in leadership in the church. There's no place for Reuben. Reuben, the excellency of my strength, but unstable as water, unstable. You cannot depend upon him. He's my firstborn, and yet he's unstable as water. Rootless Reuben, no root, no standing. And because he has no root, the wind will blow him. I pray you'll not be like that. There's no place for Saul, self-centered Saul. Wait for 7 days. And then when I saw that you didn't come on the seventh day, that's why I took laws into my hand. There's no room for that. And then there's no room for Haman, hardened Haman. He's busy setting gallows for this and setting gallows for that. Anybody who does not bend down to him, anybody who does not prostrate or kneel down, he says, I cannot even bear. You know, I came and they will not bend down to me. And there's no place for Haman, hardened Haman, in the leadership of the church. There's no room for Iscariot. You know Iscariot? Incorrigible Iscariot. I tell you, that one of you will betray me. And he said, who is he? Who is this? Is the man that I put his sop in his mouth. And he put his sop in his mouth. And Jesus said, Iscariot, Judas Iscariot, you're still bent on doing what you are going to do. Okay, go and do it. But you know, it were better you were not born. There's no place for Pilate. Place seeking Pilate. The Pilate that will know, I find no fault in him. But he must use Jesus to reconcile with Herod, Pilate. He must use Jesus to appease the bloodthirsty Jews. And then he brought a bowl of water. I want to show you, I don't have any hands in this. And then he washed his hand and he still scorched him. and he delivered him to be crucified. There's no place for a Pilate who knows the truth, who cannot stand upon the truth, and is washing his hand. I'm innocent. No, you are not innocent. I pray it will not be like that. The attitude and the action of Lucifer, of Esau, of Absalom, of Diotrephes, of Eli, of Reuben, of Saul, of Haman, of Iscariot, of Pilate, disqualifies us from leadership. This is a new year. We want to make sure that at the beginning of the year, all these things are cleansed from our lives and from our leadership in Jesus' name. Did anybody say amen over there? Now we come to point number three, fruit bearing for Christ with love and maturity. Fruit bearing for Christ with love and maturity. And now after these many years in leadership, we shouldn't be acting, we shouldn't be behaving as if we were just, journey just come. We just came into leadership. And we've never had anything about leadership. Our lives should be different. Our leadership should be different. And we should come to the year with a new zeal and with a new love and with a new maturity and lead as if I have this chance again. I'm going to make use of this chance and I will lead the way that reward will come eventually. I pray God grants us new grace. Great grace, higher grace, dependable grace in Jesus' name. And let's look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 7. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 7. It says in verse 7, but we were gentle among you. Paul, a change had taken place. This is the man before his conversion. He will run into houses, rush into houses. Any man, any woman, any youth, he got there, following after the way of Christ. He had no sympathy. He had no love. He had no consideration for the aged or for the young, for the man or the woman. But now, we were gentle among you. That's evidence of conversion. That's the evidence of grace. That's the evidence of sanctification. We were gentle among you as a nurse cherishes her children, so being affectionately desirous of you. We were willing to have imparted unto you not only the gospel, not the gospel of God only, but also our own souls, because you are dear unto us, because you are dear unto us. A pastor should count every member of the church precious and dear, and then be willing to impart his very life unto that member. For ye remember, brethren, our labor and travail, for laboring night and day, because we would not be chargeable to any of you. We preached unto you the gospel of God. Ye are witnesses, and God also, how holily and justly and unblameably we behaved ourselves among you that believe. You see, the love we have will make us to consider our leadership, will make us to consider the way we handle people, the way we relate with people, and the things we do. We will not deliberately do anything to any member, to any minister, to the ones who are junior to us, to the one at par with us, and to the one above us, in any way that will not show the love of Christ and the maturity of the Christian minister. Well then, a Christian leadership would have, number one, compassionate leadership. Compassionate leadership. We're leaders, but we're compassionate. We're leaders, we have good heart. We're leaders, we have empathy. We have sympathy. We have compassionate leadership. Number two, considerate leadership. Considerate. We consider those who are young. We consider those who are widows. We consider those who are sick. We're considered, those who are poor, we're considerate in, doling out commandments and telling them, do this and do this. We count the people more important than our little joy, our little position. We count the people. We're to use our position to solve their problems. We're to use our position to help them and to lift them up. Our leadership will be considerate leadership. Number three, conciliatory leadership. Will not have the attitude or the method of divide and rule. Divide and rule. Go to this one and tell them something bad about the other group, and go to the other group, tell this other one something bad, and then act in a way to divide so that we'll get the people to rule. No conciliatory. You reconcile people and you make people love each other. What do you lose? If we love each other, what do you lose if there's no fight? What do you lose if there's no strife? What do you lose if we all love Christ and Christ loves us and we all are going on in love? What do you lose? There must be conciliatory leadership. There must be corrective leadership. Corrective leadership. We're there as leaders. Why? Because the people are not perfect. And you want to get to them to perfect whatever is wrong in their lives. What's wrong in their family? What's wrong in their attitude to work? What's wrong in their ethics? What's wrong in their disposition? What's wrong in their relationship with other members of the church? Your leadership should be corrective. Corrective leadership. Constructive leadership. Number five, you're constructing. You're not demolishing. You're not destroying. You're not scattering. You're not making people's life unworthy and scattered. You're not making people to get so much in despair. They want to go and commit suicide. You're constructive. And if you're going to be constructive, you have to have a vision. You have to have a goal. You have to have an ideal. This is the way their life should be. Look at an architect. He sees a vacant land, or he sees a ramshackle building, and then he has a vision, he has a mind. I'm going to put a building like this on that same parcel of land. And then he breaks down that ramshackle building and constructively raises up something new. That's what we should do in people's lives. Look at their lives. They are ruined and they are wretched. And they don't amount to anything. And you go to them because you are the leader. And you have constructive influence over them. Number six is courageous leadership. Courageous leadership. That no matter what, and no matter the situation, and no matter how fiery or fearful that person is, fearsome that person is, you know, God has sent you to him. God has sent you to her. And courageously, in your leadership, you begin to transform their lives by the word that will make their lives better. Number one is compassionate leadership. Number two is considerate leadership. Number three is conciliatory leadership. Number four is corrective leadership. Number five, constructive leadership. Number six, courageous leadership. Number seven, contagious leadership. If we lead like that, people see us, people see our lives, and people see that we're more and more and more like Christ. It will spill over them. It will influence them. That love, that maturity, that leadership will be contagious, and the church, the whole flock, will be better for it in Jesus' name. The Lord will do it more in us, more in you, more in everyone. And the Lord will make us the leader he has called us to be, following after the footsteps of the Lord Jesus Christ. Is that possible? I said, is that possible? Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. Take all that we have learned today. Let's really pray. Let's really pray. And the Lord will do it in every one of our lives.